I think that we have done a good job of touching on some topics and getting people to pause for a moment and just truly rethink the way that they do business.
Welcome to Behind the Numbers Brand Anatomy, an all-new eMarketer podcast that looks under the hood of your favorite brands, made possible by Neustar. It's October 13th, and I'm your host, Insider Intelligence Briefing Director Jeremy Goldman, and this is the show that gets inside brands and dives deep into one of their recent campaigns or discusses the ROI behind a new technology they've adopted. Today, we're talking with Brian Rowley, VP of Marketing at Panasonic. Welcome, Brian.
Hey, Jeremy. Thanks for having me.
Here's what we have on deck for you today. First, a speed intro where we get to know our guest in 100 seconds or less. Then, tell me something I don't know, where yours truly and this week's guest will bring a number, stat, or study that we find particularly fascinating and or relevant. And then we jump into this week's case study, how Panasonic leverages podcast marketing in order to grow its brand. All right, Brian, time for your speed intro, where we get to know you and see how you think on your feet.
I'm ready.
100 seconds on the clock. Our producer, Victoria, will be timing you. Your time starts now. Where are you from?
Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Okay. What is your primary goal at Panasonic?
I'm responsible for marketing across four business units within the organization.
Okay. You need to order a pizza with two toppings. What toppings?
Pineapple and ham.
Which Disney princess would you be and why?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I guess Ariel because, vibrant and exciting.
Sounds good. As I can tell that you are so far. What's brand that you especially admire?
I love the Nike brand. I think they do a great job.
Oh, good call. You wake up and learn that the earth will explode in 3 hours. What do you do with that time?
Grab my dogs and head out for a good long walk.
Favorite podcast that has nothing to do with marketing or business?
Dear Albie.
Huh. Haven't heard that one. Gonna look it up right after this. And yeah. A very important final question. You're doing quite well. 25 seconds to go. Seinfeld or Friends?
Oh, Friends. Absolutely.
Completion with 20 seconds to go. Congratulations.
Wow. That was my most nervous part about this whole podcast. So we got through that piece. This is going to be a breeze now.
You might rue saying that. We might make it hard on you now just because you said that. But no. That was really fantastic. Now it is time for Tell Me Something I Don't Know. This is the segment where we each bring an interesting number, stat, study, finding that most folks won't know about, but will be highly relevant to brand marketers. And we explained why it matters. Here's what I'm bringing, okay? I was just reading this really interesting study from Skift and Amazon Web Services all about digital transformation. And I know that that's been such an important topic to so many different organizations. And I thought of you guys because I know Panasonic is going through a bit of a transformation behind the scenes in terms of your business units and, you know, how you're operating. So I thought it was really interesting to look at how much of a priority is digital transformation for your business. 67% of organizations said it was very important. 24% said it was somewhat important. And you can go down the list, but 1% said very unimportant. And I'm just wondering, you know, is that 1% going to be in business a year from now? But anyway, that's my stats that I'm bringing. Brian, your thoughts?
Yeah, it's interesting. Digital transformation is a key element to what we're doing within our business. And it actually sits within one of three pillars that we as an organization have. So digital transformation, agility and agile operations, and actually a high performance culture are actually three of our top three targets that we have as an organization. And what we see as being sort of fundamental in being able to grow the business and expand the business.
You know, it's interesting because try to have a conversation without mentioning the word pandemic and see how long you go, exactly. Right? But some other data that I saw in the study is it said, how did the COVID-19 pandemic impact your digital transformation plans for technology, investment, and deployment? 15% said no impact at all. 39% said small and minimal. 27% large or significant. And then there are a few other categories. But where would you put Panasonic in relation to that?
Yeah, quite honestly, I think it was instrumental in helping us. And I say that, which I think is a two-folded, and there's probably two parts to that answer, because I think one of the things that we saw as a business was we were a lot more agile than we thought we were. So as many companies, we had to transform our workforce from an in-office group of individuals, right, who reported to brick and mortar every single day to a remote workforce. And we did that in a period of, you know, 45 to 60 days. Whereas when you look at anything that we've done as an organization to be able to accomplish that, if you had said to us, hey, how long is it going to take you to do this type of a transformation with the workforce itself? It probably would have been something we would have said that it probably would have taken us a year to talk about it and then a good year, year and a half for us to actually do a phase approach and with a probably an ultimate plan of like a 3-year plan. And we did that in 60 days. So I think that just shows you just how agile and how much willing and really, quite honestly, that a lot of the infrastructure needed to be able to accomplish that was already in place. It was just someone to push us to actually execute against what we had already had in plan already.
Yeah, in some ways, it's like the unintended silver lining of all of this. You know, nobody would wish it, but there was obviously a lot of acceleration that happened. How about you? This is your turn to throw some data at me and let me reflect on something. So what do you got?
Yeah. So, I, you know, interesting for me, I know, you know, you're obviously, we're having a podcast. Podcasts are obviously a key part to what we do. And, you know, analytics around podcasts are one of the things that many of us struggle with, right? What shows success around that? One of the stats that came out from Buzzsprout was that the median for all podcasts is about 28 downloads. So when you think about that, I mean, you sort of look at sort of where we are in terms of a median, in terms of what's there. And that's from a B2B perspective, right? Not necessarily from some of the more consumer type approaches to podcasting or the celebrity type podcasters. But from a business perspective, average podcast median is 28 downloads. Curious your thoughts on that.
So it's interesting. It's amazing. It also doesn't surprise me on some level, just because of the fact that the ease of podcasting, it's gotten so much easier, right? Like, I have an amazing team working with me to put on this podcast, and I know you have some great resources. But over the last year or two, particularly during COVID, there have been a lot of really great, easy, almost a WYSIWYG type of ways to start a podcast. And right. I think if you're a small business and you start something and you get 28 downloads, maybe that's okay because it didn't cost you that much to actually implement it. And I think I've heard a lot of people say that those, you know, fourth tier podcasts will go away. And I'm not quite sure that they will. I think that for a lot of people, that will be good enough and they'll continue to do it because the ease of actually implementation has gotten so much easier. What do you think?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, the entrance into podcasting is fairly minimal, right? There's not a tremendous amount of investment. I think the investment in podcasting is really the preparation and determining who your audience and who your guests are. I think that's where the challenge comes in. That's where it becomes a little bit more difficult. But it's a platform that obviously a lot of people have adopted. A lot of people have been successful, I guess, in their minds as well as in the market's minds based on 28 downloads, right? If that's what we're using as our benchmark. And it's a great way to have some really good conversations and allow people the opportunity to listen at their leisure, right? When it's good for them.
So what you're saying is I should have prepared for this interview. I
should have put the time. We didn't do that.
But no. In all seriousness, I think that, yeah, it is really interesting. You see a lot of fragmentation in this space. And I'm excited in the case study portion to actually talk to you more about that. But first, we're going to take a quick word from our sponsor, Neustar, and then we'll be right back.
Are you prepared for marketing's next chapter? You won't want to miss Brave New Worlds 2021, the virtual marketing and analytics event of the year on November 9th and 10th. Join Brave New Worlds to learn how you can adapt to the forces redefining advertising. It's free, and you'll hear from today's top minds in marketing, data, and analytics, including executives from Facebook, General Motors, Capgemini, Publicis, and more. Go to bravenewworlds.newstar to register.
All right, now it's time for our brief case study, where we look at a recent brand campaign or deployment and discuss what went right and some learnings for next time. So first off, I was really curious, Brian, like what was the genesis of what was it like convincing Panasonic to launch its own podcast? And then I'm going to, you know, grill you on the particulars.
Actually, it didn't really involve a lot of convincing. I think when we looked at it, as an opportunity for us to reach an audience and allow that audience to interact with us when it was convenient for them. And that's been a big focal point for me in the role that I play, is making sure that the topics that industry is talking about or our customers want to talk about, we're able to provide answers to those conversations in multiple mediums. So we use white papers, we use podcasts, we use blog, we use social media. It was an extension and allowed us the opportunity to reach a completely different segment of the population that we wanted the opportunity to be able to be there for.
And when you set out to launch, how did you think about your objectives as an organization? Because obviously, if you're part of a larger organization, you have certain things that you're trying to accomplish, and a podcast is a great way to do it if you put that thought into it beforehand, I imagine, right?
Yeah. So when we initially started talking about this, one of the big focus areas that I had was I didn't want this to be an advertisement for our company. What I wanted it to be was a place that people could come to and we could provide insight and thought leadership, honestly, in areas that they were interested in. So it wasn't about talking about our products. If our products came up in discussion, that was fine, but that was never the intent of it. It was never the intent for it to be a commercial for Panasonic. So I think what we've done well in the process is I think that we have done a good job of touching on some topics and getting people to pause for a moment and just truly rethink the way that they do business and allow them an opportunity to hear from folks that are experts in some of the industries that we play in on some of the ways that they've been successful and challenge people to just get outside of their comfort zone and think about their business in a different way.
How do you measure success at the big rethink? And this can definitely be, if you want to, you know, to be the moment of the episode where you share some data with us that you haven't released elsewhere. But if not, I'll keep grilling you for it, because that's something I think our audience is very interested in.
Yeah, so I think, you know, for us, we gauge success a couple of different ways. We look at it as an opportunity to target a new market, a market that we hadn't been able to reach before. When you look at how we do that, I mean, we promote our podcast through social media. We tend to redirect folks back to our site as a way to be able to download episodes. We're also available on Spotify and Apple iTunes and all of the places that you would. But, you know, what we ended up seeing as a result of it was we saw on our site, we saw growth in the amount of time people were sitting and spending on our website, and growth in the magnitudes of, you know, 30 to 40% more time than they were spending prior to us launching. So it's been helpful in terms of our abilities to be able to deliver a message, one that clearly resonates and also gives us the benchmark to be able to see just how much time people are willing to spend with us because of the relevance of the information that we're providing.
Got it. So just to clarify, that's time spent on a branded Panasonic property.
Right. Yeah. That we directed to as a result of a topic that we were covering on our podcasts.
Okay.
Because our podcast, we sit actually on, you know, our site as one of the ways for people to be able to consume that information.
Makes perfect sense. Disclaimer, I listened to all of the episodes, or at least a lot of them, on the, you know, site itself. So clearly it's working. I know you have an extensive background in lead gen. So when a corporation's launching a podcast initiative and they're used to capturing leads in the old fashioned way, quote unquote, how should they think about podcasting vis-a-vis lead gen? Because, you know, I'm sure it benefits lead gen on some level, but it's not the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, again, I think it's an opportunity for you to have a deeper conversation. You know, when you look at sort of top funnel, mid funnel, and then lower funnel, right? When you start to look at where podcasting comes in, I mean, I think people need to look at it the same way they would when you would serve, let's use nurturing those leads through funnel, right? You would serve up content via a white paper. You would serve up content via potentially a video case study, all of those types of things. Podcasting to me is a way to serve up content in an environment where the consumption of that content is at you as the consumer's pace at which you're comfortable in doing it. So I say that because I think it provides a lot of flexibility. When you look at white papers and you're in your car, you're riding your bike, I will tell you, me personally, I like to ride and I listen to podcasts while I'm riding, right? That's one of the things that I do. I couldn't read a white paper or shouldn't be watching a video while I'm doing that because it just doesn't
become safe. I hope not. Yeah.
Exactly. So I think it gives you the flexibility to deliver your content at a more opportune time, again, where the individual who's consuming absorbs it at their pace and when they're ready to do it. And I think it's just proven for us to be very effective.
And speaking of effectiveness, I know one thing you probably want to be effective about is communicating how Panasonic has transformed over the last X number of years, right? How does the Big Rethink help you transform the way that people think about Panasonic from, you know, a consumer brand to a company that operates more and more within certain, you know, B2B categories?
Yeah, I think what it does is it allows us the opportunity to expose to a larger audience some of the things that are important and relevant to us based on the guests that we're pulling in and the topics that we're talking about. For years, Panasonic was known as a company that is focused on TVs. TVs, if you ask someone, what is Panasonic most known for? You know, that's the response that we get. The reality of that is, you know, 90% of our business is B2B business today. So when you look at that as an overall, that shift that's taken place, a big part of that, people don't even understand what some of those categories are. So, you know, when you are riding through a city or a town, there's a good likelihood that your police, fire, EMS are using one of our Toughbook laptops or tablets. When you look at, you know, what we do in the theme park and immersive entertainment space, things like the Van Gogh, Illuminariums, those some of the more immersive things that are popular at this time, Panasonic is playing a part in that. No one would expect that we are in house of worship. People don't look to us on factory floors. They don't look at us in terms of developing chipsets, which go in a lot of the technology that's happening and that you're participating in every single day. So it's given us an opportunity to share some more visibility in some of the key areas and businesses that we're focused on, as well as just open, you know, some eyes to some of the things that are important to us as a business and things that we gravitate towards.
Well, this is another thing I was very curious about. You have everyone on from, and this is what I love, this broad swath of people that you're pulling from futurist academics to VCs to media moguls. How do you select guests and make sure that they're brand aligned and that, you know, they kind of help flesh out and in some ways enlarge and, you know, make Panasonic come to life in the process as opposed to cause some kind of brand, you know, misalignment issues?
Obviously, you're very cautious of who you bring on to make sure that there is that alignment. But I would say that, you know, the intent of the Big Rethink has always been to expand thought, right? So it's diversity of thought, providing people the opportunity to see things through the lens that might be different than the lens that they're normally used to seeing that through. And so we like to look at it and say that, you know, when we select guests, they have to align with core values of the business. That's a key part to it. But the other side to it too is relevance, making sure that the guest is relevant and a topic that our audience, whether that's a customer, current or future, is interested in. You mentioned the futurist. We talked to Brian Alexander of Georgetown University about sort of the future of education. There isn't a bigger topic right now than what's happening in the higher ed space, specifically between hybrid learning, remote learning, in-person learning, the impacts that has to faculty, students, parents who might be paying the bill, right? Are they getting the experience that they wanted to? So we really look for the relevance. That is probably the most important part of our selection and guest is how relevant is that conversation to the conversation that our customers are looking or expecting us to have.
So a marketer always wants to listen to their customers as much as possible, at least a marketer that wants to keep their job. How do you prioritize customer feedback and voice of the customer, VOC, with respect to a corporate podcast? Because that's one issue I would say about a podcast is that it doesn't inherently have this built-in feedback loop, and you kind of have to work hard to figure out what you're doing right, what you're doing wrong.
Yeah. I think that feedback on the podcasts themselves can be challenging, no doubt. I think what we look for is feedback in regards to the relevance of the topic. So, you know, we're out there trying to make sure that the topics are topics that we know are first in mind of individuals that are out there. I'll give you an example. You know, I mentioned that public sector is a place that we play. So, you know, some of the differences that you may see as millennial officers enter the workforce and the law enforcement area versus more tenured officers. There's different requirements. There's different expectations specific around technology, different things like that. We also look at it from the officer safety perspective. How do we help create the technology that's needed in order for that agency to provide a safe environment for the officer that's out in the field? Education, I mentioned faculty, I mentioned students, you know, so it's really the relevant factor, right, is really the piece that we really are shooting for.
Can I ask you one or two more critical questions? Can't let you get off that easy. I mean, what's one mistake that you made in the early days of the podcast that if you wanted to, you could go back? And that could be from a production, from a marketing, from any standpoint.
Yeah, I think the initial reaction. So this actual podcast started out as a podcast called Rugged Rants, and it was intended to specifically target a market that we had around our laptops, tablets, and handheld devices. And so I think the biggest mistake we made was probably not realizing the scope and breadth of what podcasting can do, which quickly transformed those conversations from that specific product line to some of the bigger conversations that are happening around the industry. So I think just being too narrow-minded almost in the potential of podcasting was probably one of the biggest weaknesses. And I also mentioned to you early on that we also wanted to try to get away from the thought of having this be very product-centric and be more thought leadership directive. And I think at the very beginning, we tended to have guests who were either Panasonic employees or someone who was associated with the organization come on. And we quickly moved and pivoted from that to be a broader audience covering broader topics.
Which is a great call because, of course, I think and even if that's a really great brand ambassador that you have on, really articulate, then people just on some level, they tune out because they're just like, oh, well, this is the brand talking about themselves. Of course, they're going to be promotional. And yeah, I think that very smart call, you know, obviously you live, you learn. I got to ask you, because of course, that's in the early days. But when you look at what you're doing now, what's one opportunity to improve? What's something that you're just not doing that well on right now, or you just see a lot of room for growth?
Yeah, I mean, I think promoting, to be honest with you, we don't promote the podcast. We do it more organically. And I think there's an opportunity here for us to actually promote it more. There's a lot of value in it. You know, this particular podcast happens to be an external one. As a result of the success we saw with this, we also did an internal podcast. So we even communicate with our own employees via podcast. So, you know, there's some great opportunity there. But I think the abilities to really promote it more than what we have been is probably the biggest opportunity I think we have.
Well, I will be watching and following to see whether or not you do that. But yeah, I've really enjoyed the episodes that I've caught. So thank you so much, Brian.
Thank you for the opportunity. Great conversation, and I appreciate your time.
Well, that's it for today's episode. I really enjoyed that conversation with Brian, and we would love to know what you thought of it. Let us know what you think at podcast@emarketer.com. I'll be back in 2 weeks for another episode of the Behind the Numbers Brand Anatomy. Make sure to tune in tomorrow for the Behind the Numbers Daily and eMarketer podcast made possible by Neustar.